Good morning. It is God's day. It is Sunday. Welcome to God's church. I hope everybody had a happy and great Thanksgiving, got a lot to eat, and enjoyed themselves immensely. Oh, yeah, I saw that. That's good. You know, I'm noticing as we passed through it, we had, what, Black Friday, now Cyber Monday, and all of those other things. And, some days I feel like maybe we're talking about the money changers in the church when everybody's out immediately after it, because Christmas is coming, and it's coming awfully fast. And I just ask all of us to remember what the true meaning of Christmas is as we approach the season and consider that as being more important maybe than all of the Christmas shopping. You going to... Your present yet? Oh, yeah. Darned, I forgot something. I knew it was. Okay, Cyber Monday is Monday. No, we're going back to what we should be. Let's remember Christmas for what it is and what it's supposed to be for. Announcements-wise, I was asked for sure to remind everybody that the Reach store needs plastic bags, so small little plastic bags we get for everything we buy anymore. We use those to recycle and turn back into the products that we do sell at the store, which reminds me that the store is going to be open Tuesday through Friday from 10 o'clock till 5, Saturday from 10 o'clock until 2. So it is still open, still closed on Mondays. Give everybody a day of rest to take a day off. If you have things that you no longer need that are good quality, the store would love to have them. If you would like to buy good quality things, the store has them. Please drop in and see the folks at the store. Men's breakfast tomorrow morning, 7 o'clock at Potbelly Deli. So, men, we have coffee, we have breakfast, the eye-opener to get us started. Let's say bingo at Archie's, again, is still on Mondays from 3 o'clock until 6. It is also Tuesdays from 6 o'clock until 9. And also our Boundary Series, the program that we have every Tuesdays. It's a book, am I correct?
It comes in a book, but they don't get the book, they get worksheets.
Okay, worksheets, okay. Part 3 is going to be Tuesdays from 3 o'clock to 7 o'clock. Now it says here on the bulletin that Thursdays will begin after the New Year's Day, but Thursdays will go on, but the Bible study will not happen until a New Year's Day, so Ophelia's taking the time off. Okay, part 3 to 7. Okay, I guess we're going to be here early. Anyway, those are the major announcements. Again, we do need the bags. The store is here. Welcome to church at Reach, and we're going to turn it over to our singers.
Thank you, Jim. All right, I'm going to actually, Miss Mary has a little announcement she'd like to make in regard to her daughter.
Yes. Thank you. A lot of you have met my daughter, Jessica. Whenever she comes down from Atlanta, she always comes to church here. But I wanted to read a little email that she sent out to me the other day. And I wanted to share it with you. She says, as most of you know, missions is a big part of my life. I am blessed to be able to work with an organization that sole purpose is to send out missionaries across the globe. During my time at Mission to the World, I have been able to serve on a short-term mission trips, each of which has taught me more about who God is and what He is doing all over the world. In January, I will be joining a team going to Greece to work with the thousands of refugees that are streaming into the country. The Greek Evangelical Church, Mission to the World missionaries, and our other partners in Greece are responding to the needs of these refugees and have asked for small teams to come and assist them with various projects. The situation is changing daily, and it is causing a huge burden on the church in Greece and the workers there. Our goal is to relieve some of this stress and to encourage the church and to be available to do whatever helps them. We will have the opportunity to work at the Center of Hope, a center for women and children that offers them a place to shower, just relax, and fellowship with other refugees. We may also have the opportunity to work at a newly opened school for the refugee children. In order to be able to take this trip, I need your help. First and foremost, I need your prayers. Please pray for safety, that the Lord would use me to encourage and support the Greek church and our missionaries, and that I would be able to be a light to the refugees. I also need financial partners to make this trip possible. I need to raise $2,000 by January the 10th. It seems like a huge task to me, but I trust that God provides for those he has called. And I spoke with Wendy this morning, and she said if there are any of you that feel led to make a small donation for Jesse, you can put it in an envelope in the box and just put Jessica on it, and she'll make sure that we get it and send it to her. But most and foremost of all, as she said, if you would just pray for their safety and for the work that they do. Thanks.
All right. Thank you, Mary. And Mary, with her daughter going to Greece, a lot of people don't know this little known fact. That's where the first French fries were made. In Greece. Didn't make sense at first, did it? It's true. So remember Greece, the people of Greece. All right. So did everybody have a great Thanksgiving? Good. Been a busy weekend for a lot of people and a lot of family. And I just want to welcome you. There's a lot of new faces here today, and we're getting ready to gear up here as season comes back in. I want to remind you guys, as we get fuller and fuller, if you have some folding chairs to carry with you, maybe for Sunday services, when all the seats are full, you're going to be going, all the seats are full, and you're going to be arguing over who's reserving seats for who, and we know we don't save seats for people here because we don't sell those little bronze plaques where you have your name on your chair. So, well, we probably should, though, because a lot of people come through the week and they need their name on their chair so they can find them. Anyway... So just that being said, if you remember to bring a folding chair, when the church gets full, you can set up right out in here. You can set up right here if you want to, but if you bring your own chair, you won't be striving for a seat. How's that? Fair enough? All right. My own little early reminder. So let's open up with a word of prayer. Again, if you want to support Jessica, I think it's always a good cause to reach out to mission fields. Our local mission is doing great through the thrift store. And if you want to be a volunteer at the thrift store, generally, Miss Jeannie is in on Thursdays, and we'd like to train you so that we're not just showing up and going, okay, now what do we do, because we're busy doing something. So if you'd like to come do that, we'd like to have some training on Thursdays, and if you're interested, just call me or the store, and we'll set that up for you, and we can get you on a schedule. Let's open up with a word of prayer, and we'll get into this worship service. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for the weekend. We thank you for the travel mercies and the safety for people that did travel and make it home. God, I'm hearing over the weekend of so many different things that have happened, lost loved ones and auto accidents and whatnot. Father, we know that you are the great healer. You are the great comforter. And God, you will give the words to those who you call to reach out to those individuals as they feel led. Father, it's my... biggest privilege and my biggest honor to be able to share your truth with every individual in the world, that they might be able to hear your voice, be led of you, and walk in righteousness. With this all being said, God, we come here today to worship you and to praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. What do we do? Change the playlist up? That was last week's, I think. Today's the 27th. No worries, no worries. You know, it just goes to show you, not everybody's perfect. My uncle always told me when everybody's perfect, they'll stop putting erasers on pencils. So that's how you'll know. Good sign. You got to know what signs to look for. Yeah, morning, great. Carl. How are you,
hi,
sir?
Carl.
It's great to be here. Go right ahead. We'll turn the microphone on for you. Thanks for letting us know. That's the ladies' room. Wow. Now that's the men's room. Good. Look for the sign with the, yeah, without the skirt.
Your love, O Lord, reaches to the heavens, and your faithfulness stretches to the sky. Your righteousness is like a mighty mountain. Oh yeah. Your justice flows like the ocean tide. I will lift my find my strength in the shadow of your wings. Reaches to the heavens.
That's why we practice.
Your faithfulness, it stretches to the sky. Your righteousness is like a mighty mountain, oh yeah, and your justice flows like the ocean tide. So I will live.
For the fun of it.
When he rolls up his sleeves, he ain't just putting on the Ritz.
Our God is an awesome God.
There's thunder in his footsteps and lightning in his fists.
Our God is an awesome God.
And the Lord joking when he kicked him out of Eden. It wasn't for no reason that he shed his blood. His return is very soon, so you better be believing.
Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven.
Starless in the void of the night.
Our God is an awesome God.
He spoke into the darkness and created the light.
Our God is an awesome God.
Judgment and wrath, he brought it down on Sodom. Mercy and grace, he gave us at the cross. I hope that we have not too quickly forgotten that
our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God.
Our friend Judy has been going through chemo, and all of her growths in her system are cut in half. They're shrinking, and she's giving God the glory and the credit.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm alive and well, your spirit lives within me, because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit lives within me, because you died and rose again. Amazing love. You
Are you lost, Niecy?
Without me.
Let the poor man say, I am rich in him. Let the lost man say, I am found in him. Oh, let the river flow. Let the blind man say, see again. Let the dead man say, I am born again. Oh, let the river flow. Oh, let the river flow. Let the river flow. Let the river flow.
I can name that tune in two notes. All right. I don't know if you can tell or not, but we're in the book of Corinthians, and we're working on, I believe, chapter 9 today. If I turn my notes over, I'll know for sure. Whew. Been busy, busy, busy. It's been a busy couple of days for the last few years, I must say. 1 Corinthians 9. We're going to be talking about our rights, and what kind of rights do we actually have? I remember going into a lot of recovery training. I remember going into this leadership conference that I went to, and some of the things that we stand up for, thinking that they're rightfully ours. I have the right to a whole lot of things, but when I first got saved, I went to a counselor who teaches something really similar to the Alpha series, and it was called the Exchanged Life Ministries. And what we talk about in our church is exactly that, the life exchange that we made from who we were to who we are as a new believer in Christ, that the old man is dead and everything has become new. Well, if you know a little piece of my story, about 23 and a half, 24 years ago, I was had really strong suicidal tendencies, and I didn't tell anybody. I did it all on my own. I had this plan. The scary part is when somebody announces that they're thinking about killing themselves, a lot of times it's a cry for help or a cry for attention, but sometimes it's for real. And I've done a lot of suicide prevention training now, and you need to take that very seriously if somebody says they're thinking about ending their life. The unfortunate part for me was that I didn't mention it to anybody. I just made my plan, and I went about it quietly because I felt like I was all alone. And what happened for me was I went to, and I believe, here's what I believe. I believe that God had found me. I didn't believe I was looking for God. As a matter of fact, I would have told you I wasn't looking for God. I had no inclination toward God because a lot of things that I saw in the church and in religiosity was not attractive to me at all. It's one of the reasons we do church here is because we want to reach people who are not inclined to look at a building that has a steeple, because a lot of times my thoughts were, there's nothing in there for me. I've been to a bunch of church services. I've listened to a whole bunch of religious messages, and there was nothing in there for me, in my opinion. And I'm not telling you this because it's true. I'm telling you it because my thinking was confused. The last thing in the world that I thought I needed was God, but it was the very thing that I did need. And I can tell you that God found me because he led me to read a book called Codependent No More. He led me to go to a meeting that night on a Thursday. It happened to be at what was then called the Savannah's Mental Health Unit. It's a Port St. Lucie hospital. And it was about codependency. And for the first time, I felt like somebody out there might understand me, because there was a whole group of people who were going to this meeting who felt exactly the way I did. In that meeting, somebody told me that they had been going there for 6 years, and that a few months prior, a friend of hers had told her, if you want God's help, all you have to do is ask. And she shared this with me that night, and I kind of rolled my eyes, if I get honest. Yeah, whatever. And I walked away, and I cried all the way home, because I was tired of trying to do life on my terms. When I got home, I looked at the instruments that I had laid on the table, and I'd just be real, it is what it is now. I can look back. It was a really dark time. I literally had cried myself to sleep for 3 months. I'm sorry, 3 weeks. And I literally would scream myself awake from nightmares that I had every single night for 3 weeks. I felt like I was tormented. And I didn't want to live that way anymore. So I went home, and I had these things on my table, and I had a plan. See, there's a question you ask when somebody says they don't want to live anymore. The first question is, do you have a plan? My answer probably would have been no if you asked me, because I didn't want anyone to know. But it would have been yes, the reality of it. Yes, I had a plan. The next question that's appropriate to ask is, do you have a schedule? I had a plan and a schedule. Knowing what I know now in suicide prevention training, I was way over the edge. Way over. I told myself that by 8 o'clock tomorrow morning, if something hadn't changed, I was checking out. It was that close. Well, I looked at all these things on the table. I had my gun. I had 3 bottles of pills. I had a razor blade, and I had my car keys. And I put them there before I went to the meeting. And I left them there when I got home, and I reaffirmed to myself what I was going to do. One, if not all, checking out. And as soon as I made my mind up to turn around and go to bed, I literally heard a voice in my apartment. And I heard these words, if you want my help, all you have to do is ask. There wasn't no church people around. There was no pastors. There was no counselors. It was me and God, one-on-one. And I dropped to my knees and I cried. And I said, if you're real, you better do something quick. Well, the worst thing that ever happened to my life was that moment, but it's become the best thing that's ever happened to me. because he entered my life that night. And I started a journey. Fortunately, I went to a counselor who teaches what we teach, who did not teach religion, who did not teach, oh, just say the magic words and you'll be saved. See, it's about being genuine. It's about being real. And I can't express enough how I would like you to be real with God, and that God would be real with you, that you understand that when you were saved, he placed his spirit inside of you to lead you and to guide you. He speaks to you in the most subtle ways, in persistent thoughts. They'll line up with his written word. Circumstances will readjust. And then your job is to step out in faith and do as called. That's how this church started. I had no idea I was going to be visiting churches 23 and a half years ago. If you would have told me 3 days before that I would go to church, I would have laughed in your face. The people who knew me as I grew up in Maine knew that I was raised in a little country church, and by the time I was 15 or 16, I was running wild, wide open. When I lost my mom to cancer at 23, I cranked it on even more. I ran. I was angry. I was still angry after I was saved. But God's making changes every day, and he will continue. The good news is, and it is good news, the good news is that God does love you. The good news is not that if you don't turn, you're going to burn. That's not good news. The good news is you can experience heaven now. You can accept God in your life. You can start to learn to lead a life based on his leading, not your own wisdom. There's so much teaching about it. The Alpha series is plain, the most plain study I've ever done with the scriptures and the gospel of grace. It's about trusting God. If you'll just hear his voice and walk. Our problem is this nasty flesh, this old man, still wants to rear its ugly head, still wants to be right all the time. And I can teach you about that. In a counseling session, I do it all the time. This is our problem. I got my right. So where did this all come from, and why did it all come from here? When I went to that counseling session, I went to about 3 sessions. See, I had had enough. I was willing to do anything except my way. And by the 3rd session, this counselor handed me a contract, and it said, are you willing to give up your rights to, colon, and it had a whole list of things. Your geographic location, what kind of car you're going to drive, what kind of job you're going to have, where you're going to live, who you're going to date. Are you willing to give up your rights to all of those things? And I said, heck yeah, I can sign this now. He said, are you serious? I said, I'm dead serious. I wasn't willing to give those up 3 weeks ago when I had a gun to my head. See, the difference is, instead of me wanting to take my life, I found that I wanted to give my life. And when I finally gave my life to God, he was willing to take it, and he was willing to do things with it that I could never have dreamed of. One of them is standing here with you people who might still be hungry for an answer. And I don't know. But I'm here doing what God called me to do, and that's sharing his love and his spirit. And if you'll accept his spirit, if you're struggling right now, I'm telling you, man, open the heart. Open it up. It's the best thing you can ever do in your life, for your life. Where he'll lead you is absolutely miraculous. Absolutely. Is my life perfect? No. Am I perfect? No. Is our marriage perfect? No. Is this church perfect? No. Is this world perfect? Far from it. Still got erasers on pencils, right? But God is the only perfect thing going. And you know what? I want to be like him. And if that's what you want in your life, then that's exactly what you'll be. You'll be what you want, because you'll be who you are. And who you are in Christ is a brand new creation. So Pastor Bob, if you want to come up for this segment of the teaching, I'm telling you, if you haven't done the study of the Alpha series, or even if you've done it once, twice, 3 times, or 5 times, do it again, do it again, do it again. I'm telling you, you'll continually grow in the Spirit.
When is your next Alpha?
Probably after.
All right, so we're going to have a new alpha after the first of the year. That is exciting. That is so many lives changed through that teaching of the gospel and coming to understand ourselves and why we do what we do and how to get that peace and freedom. We are in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, I believe. And in this section, Paul talks about rights, okay? And in this country, in a lot of countries, we're very concerned about rights, equal rights, my rights, your rights, how to get our rights, how to keep our rights from being infringed. And part of the problem is, after a while, the focus is on us. It's on me, my rights. And we don't, think so much about the other person. And Paul starts this chapter off with asking a question. He says, and understand, there was a lot of stuff going on in this new church at Corinth, okay? And he's addressing the Corinthians. He's addressing these people. He started off this letter, if you would, his first letter in this book to the Corinthians, addressing them as saints, okay? He's not questioning their position as belonging to God, but he's questioning their falling back into the fleshly kind of thinking so soon. He says, am I not as free as anyone else? Am I not an apostle? Haven't I seen Jesus our Lord with my own eyes? Isn't it because of my work that you belong to the Lord? He's saying, I brought the message, the good news to you, okay? And they've kind of forgotten about Paul, and they've kind of ignoring Paul. And they're even questioning what authority he has. You already sense almost the beginnings of a rebellion within the church, which unfortunately has been a lot of church history over the years. He says, even if others think I'm not an apostle, I certainly am to you. You yourselves are proof that I am the Lord's apostle. And he goes into some specific things that apparently they were questioning. And this can be the difference between a healthy church and a sick church, okay? A healthy church is focused on Christ and is led by the Spirit. And you'll see that manifest itself as love. You'll see that manifest itself as people giving, not necessarily into a box somewhere monetarily, but giving of their lives. Like Dave said, I came to this place where I wanted to give my life, okay? I could probably expand on that, and I can't speak for him, but for some greater good than myself, okay? That's the sign of a healthy church. And I think we see a lot of that here. We see a lot of healthy signs. Not saying we're perfect, but I find this to be a very giving church. I see people that are concerned about each other. And it's not oh my gosh, they missed Sunday, they're bad. It's more like, I wonder if they're okay. I wonder if they're having a problem, because people care for each other. And that's healthy. But Paul says, this is my answer to those who question my authority. Don't we have the right to live in your home and share your meals? Don't we have the right to bring a Christian wife with us as the other disciples and the Lord's brothers do, and as Peter does? This brought up a question in my mind. I just wondered where they got the idea that church leaders, priests if you would, weren't to be married. If Peter was the first, I don't want to go on a religious rant, but Peter obviously had a wife. That's my point. And if we trace the church back to Peter, I think we trace the church back to Jesus Christ, and through Peter and through Paul and through the disciples and through the apostles and through the believers, it's grown. It's not about any one person or personality other than Jesus Christ, because it is about Jesus Christ. He says, is it only Barnabas and I who have to work to support ourselves? Now, Paul has been dedicated his whole life for years now to the church, to planning churches, to training new believers, to teaching them the gospel, to training them up, others like Timothy and Barnabas, to go out and expand the kingdom by sharing the word. In fact, if you want a glimpse at the early church, we can go a couple places. We can go back to Acts chapter 4, where it says in verse 32, all the believers were united in heart and mind, and they felt that what they owned was not their own, so they shared everything they had. This was the early church. But apparently, this wasn't going on at Corinth, because now they've even cut Paul off. In the early church, it says there were no needy people among them, because those who owned land or houses would sell them and bring the money to the apostles so they could drive around in big cars and have a lot of jewelry, go on vacations. No. It says to give to those in need. That was a hallmark of the early church. When you gave, see, it didn't go to support some monstrous overhead, the air conditioning bills, right? The insurance for the building, the upkeep for the building, the expansion of the building, because it was about people. It wasn't about a building. People are the body of Christ. This is what the early church was. The same, probably the same Barnabas. I'm not sure. I'd really have to research it. But it says in verse 36, for instance, there was Joseph, the one the apostles nicknamed Barnabas, which means son of encouragement. He was from the tribe of Levi and came from the island of Cyprus. He sold a field he owned and brought the money to the apostles. They were, in a word, invested. Okay? They were about loving other people. This is what the early church was about. Paul is dealing with the Corinthians, however, that have gotten off the track a little bit. So he's confronting them directly, and he's confronting them with questions and with scripture. He says, what soldier has to pay his own expenses? What farmer plants a vineyard and doesn't have the right to eat some of its fruit? What shepherd cares for a flock of sheep and isn't allowed to drink some of the milk? Am I expressing merely a human opinion, he asks, or does the law say the same thing? For the law of Moses says, you must not muzzle an ox to keep it from eating as it treads out the grain. And he goes on and he asks the question. Paul says, was God really just talking about oxen? Wasn't he really talking about people? You know, the field hands out in the field, they were allowed to have some food as they were working. They were allowed to pick from the orchard for themselves to sustain themselves. They were allowed to share in the harvest. Paul's feeling a little forgotten here. He says, yes, it was written for us so that the one who plows and the one who threshes the grain might both expect a share of the harvest. And he goes on. He says, since we planted spiritual seed among you, aren't we entitled to a physical harvest of food and drink? In other words, you know, we have physical needs too. We have to live. We're doing the work of the kingdom. We're feeding you guys spiritually. We have a right to be sustained. I knew a Christian psychologist once. We were talking about, he believed in tithing. I don't believe in tithing. Not in the law sense of a certain percentage that you must give in order to be blessed. Okay? That was old covenant. New covenant says specifically not to give out of compulsion, okay? Not out of some specific rule that you have to, not out of an attitude that I got to give, you know, this. I got to give up this for God so I'll get blessed. No, it says that God loves a cheerful giver. Give as the Spirit leads you to give. But I was having this conversation, and although I didn't agree with him on that, and he did go back to Malachi in the Old Testament to support his position, he made an interesting point. He said, give where you're being spiritually fed. He says, I give where I'm being spiritually fed. Now, that might be a radio program that's dear to your heart that you listen to regularly. It might be a ministry that's not even a church per se. But wherever you're being spiritually fed, in my opinion, that, you know, and I got to say that once as a believer, you'll find that as you're ministering to others, you're going to be spiritually fed in that. So even as you're giving, right, you're getting more. I found that when Dave first invited me to go facilitate an alpha class and just plug a video in and watch it with some guys at a rehab. And it was like, and then when I started teaching it even more, it was like, it's amazing. I would leave feeling so much even better than when I got there. I was getting. See, you can't be used by God to bless somebody without being blessed in it. Okay? That's not some legalistic prosperity spirituality that you're going to manipulate what you do to get. It's more like God makes you in his image. See, as a born-again believer, you're made in the image of Christ. And not only that, but you have Christ living in you. As you allow Christ to express himself through you, however he does that in your life, you're going to be just blessed all the more. It just truly gets better and better. That's part of the good news. Paul says, if you support others who preach to you, shouldn't we have an even greater right to be supported? But he doesn't stop there, okay? He says, but we have never used this right. We would rather put up with anything, he says, than be an obstacle to the good news of Jesus Christ. Paul put up with a lot, okay? He put up, as we've studied in previous books of the Bible, with being beaten with steel rods or rods of iron, with being whipped, with being shackled in a dungeon, with being mistreated by the guards and the soldiers, mistreated by the mobs, mistreated by the Jewish religious leaders, you know, mistreated by the cruel Roman government, everywhere he went. Suffering, change. He said, I bear the marks on my body. This guy suffered serious health consequences, but he continued. In fact, he says, I have never used any of these rights, and I am not writing this to suggest that I want to start now. I would rather die, he says, than lose my right to boast about preaching the gospel without charge. In other words, if you guys want to feed me when I visit, fine. If you don't, whatever. I'm doing what God called me to do. What if we took that attitude into our relationships, into our, dare I say, jobs? What if we took that relationships that, you know what? Maybe I don't even like being here working, but this is where God's got me, and I'm going to let him use me. And rather than gripe and complain, I'm going to do it as if I'm doing it for God. You know what? He'll use you. And you might find yourself somewhere else someday because God opens doors and closes doors. And we get so scared. How many of us will gripe and moan about a job, but when we hear that door might be closing, oh, then we get fearful, don't we? It's no way to live. Know that God's got you no matter what's going on. In fact, we're creatures. We're habit. We habitually complain, it seems. And you want a cure for that? You want a little way? You want a little way, a little challenge? Can I challenge you? Okay. You don't have to do it because I'm doing it, but if you think that maybe you complain a little too much, right? Go to complaintfreeworld. Is it .com or .org? .org. And I have 9 of these bracelets. The 10th one I'm wearing. It's a 21-day challenge, okay? To go 21 days without complaining. And it'll tell you on that website very briefly, very simply, what a complaint is. A complaint isn't the thought. It's speaking it. It's criticizing, and it's sarcasm. So if you complain, criticize, or get sarcastic, then you have to switch it to the other wrist. I've already switched it a few times, just a couple days, okay? Very often it takes 8 to 10 months for a lot of people to go 21 days without complaining. But I'm going to warn you, okay? Just like in the book, which you can order, the book is awesome. I'm just finishing it. I'm going to warn you that you will start not only recognizing your own griping and complaining, you will become sensitized to how much negativity there is around you. So it's not easy, but here's the good deal. You learn, you know what? Complaining about complainers is complaining too. You learn to adjust your own attitude, because that's the only thing we can change. And I believe that we need God's help to do it, because you're not going to do it on your own. But if anybody wants one, just see me, and you're welcome to start the challenge for yourself. And hold me accountable. If you hear me complain, okay, a factual observation is one thing. Tone is another, because negativity, there's an energy there, and if you say something with a negative energy, it's a complaint, okay? I can say, wow, it's hot out. It's not necessarily complaining. If I say, and it's hot again, all right, you know the difference. So Paul says, I've not used these rights. He said, I'm not going to demand these rights. He said, if I were doing this on my own initiative, I would deserve payment, but I have no choice. For God has given me the sacred trust. I can, he says, it is not something I can boast about. I'm compelled by God to do it. This is who Paul was. He said, I have to go share the good news. What an awesome thing to share the good news. I tried stuffing that for probably 25 or 30 years. I thought at 10 years of age that sharing the good news was what my life was going to be about. I didn't know exactly how, but I stuffed it because it wasn't, you know, I got family kind of tamped down on that. My mom was the only one that saw it for what it was. But others were like, yeah, I'm going to turn into one of those Jesus freaks. You know what? We're all a little freaky, but there ain't no better way to be freaky than be freaky for Jesus. Even though I am a free man with no master, I have become a slave to all people to bring many to Christ. He said, when I was a Jew, I lived like the Jews. In other words, I put up with stuff that I realized I didn't need to follow all that anymore. But I wanted them to come to Christ. So I came to them in love instead of criticizing and complaining about the way they did things, is what he's saying. And when I went to the Gentiles, he said, and I'll paraphrase, rather than gripe and complain about the way they did things, I lived like they did to a certain extent. He went on. He said, I will not violate Christ's command. And what was Christ's command? What is his command? Love one another as I have loved you. See, that's what this is about. This is about love. And I've experienced so much love at this church. This experience at Archie's has been an awesome and continues to be an awesome thing. If we can carry this love out into our families, into our relationships with other people, accept other people, know that it's not our job to change them. See, if we think we're going to go out and change the world for Jesus, then probably going to be sadly disappointed. If we're going to allow God to change the world and use us in the process, what a liberating way to live. You know what? It takes the pressure off, because I know who's in charge, right? My responsibility, allow him. Allow him. I was talking with a wonderful individual the other day, and he's been in AA for years and years. And he said, you know, I tried AA and I worked those steps, and it just didn't work. He said, I didn't get the spiritual part. It just didn't work. He said, and I went out for a few years. I went out back drinking and back to that lifestyle. But when I came back, I knew it had to be different. And he embraced the spiritual side of it. And he said, you know, he's had people, and he was questioning me about this because he wasn't sure what we were teaching in our faith-based program, and he was afraid that maybe we were pushing them to be religious. I said, religion will kill recovery, okay? Religion will destroy recovery. It's about the relationship. It's about the relationship. He said, when I realize that I'm just another bozo on the bus, right, and I need to be around those people in AA, I need the fellowship. And this guy's led, I don't know how many people, and sponsored, I don't know how many people, but he's so humble. We're just more bozos on the bus. And God's got us on this bus for this time. But you know what? When we realize what God has done in our lives for this bozo, then I can love that bozo. You know what? And we can all just be bozos and see people and see Christ in people. See the potential. If they don't have Christ yet, the potential that Christ has for them, and love them on this level, not that level, looking down on them. That's what religion will do, and it drives people away. It's about the way Jesus did it when you think about it. He came down here. God came down here and got on this level. It's like that song, Another Slob on the Bus. My religiosity, that used to really offend me. And now I see it. He came down here into this yucky human condition so that we could become like him.
All right. Who doesn't want to be Christ-like? Don't answer that. You'll be exposed. All right, interesting. Good stuff here, Bob. Thank you for presenting that. I got tons of stuff out of this, and I always sit over there and listen and take notes because I believe that God confirms things through other people. So as we go through your study guide and your sheet here, a lot of things came up. First and foremost, what came up is that Paul was talking to the people at the church who were believers, and he called them saints. I don't know if any of you have done that study that I've suggested. Get an online Bible. There's one called Online Bible at the Bible Gateway. You don't necessarily have to download it. You can go out on their site. You can search the whole Bible for words like sinner and sinners and saint and saints and do your own study. When you find these words wrapped around sin and sinner and sinners, I want you to read the context that they're in. And when you find the word saint or saints, I want you to read that context and tell me which one you are. Because too many people are still being preached at that you're a whole bunch of sinners in the church, and it's not true. We're saints of God. That was an important thing. Our rights. When we stand up for our rights, guess what usually happens? We get offended. Well, those people should have done this, and they should have done that for me. And then it goes right to the complaining part of what Bob was saying, right? And I got to tell you something, Bob. I know some of you guys out there heard me griping and complaining this morning about how I worked. I'm just telling on myself. See, sometimes that awareness comes through the words of another friend. But you know what? In the middle of me getting my work done over this weekend, it was really interesting how God worked that out, because I really got burnt, ticked off when I was out there working on that piece of equipment and my wife's posting pictures of me telling everybody how much fun I'm having. And I'm just telling it like it is. I was not having fun. I was seething mad, if I get honest, the whole weekend. I was. But, you know, right when I was in the middle of that driving that little rig, which I'm not a tractor driver. I learned really quick. I did. I'm trying not to knock my sheds down and bash my windows out because it was working close to the house. But in the middle of that, you know what thought entered my mind? And I believe it came from God. You know what? She can count on you to do these things. You're blessed. Isn't that cool? That's what I got. You know what? You should be thankful that you have this ability that you can do when you can do. When you're called to do, do. You know, the griping and the complaining and sarcasm, man, I'm full of it. I am full of it. And you wonder why you walk around in misery, griping and complaining and being sarcastic. And, you know, I do this little thing for myself when people come into the store and they say, how you doing? Everybody know my response? What's my F word? Some of you heard it. Come on. Fabulous. I'm doing fabulous. You know what? I'm not faking it till I'm making it. I am doing what God called me to do. I know it. And my life is fabulous. Even in the midst of my griping and complaining over the weekend, how fabulous is my life? You know, if you're counting your blessings, then you're not worried about all the rest of the junk. But guess what? That's that nasty flesh wanting to say, man, people, they should do this and they should do that. I can't help what other people think. I had a rough day on Friday, on Thursday, a lot of hard work. I was exhausted. And in my exhaustion, I guess I upset somebody. Sorry, I was out of energy. I apologize. All I could do is apologize. I can't go back and redo it. You know what I'm saying? I noticed that I missed a bunch of calls over the weekend. I noticed it, but I didn't really have the energy to respond. I was taking the weekend off to do what I had to do. And that's what I did. Interesting. This came up, and this is how God led. It is appropriate to support those who are feeding me spiritually. That's your first two blanks. Those who are feeding me spiritually. Well, we often think that that means I'm begging you for your money because me and Bob are feeding you spiritually. But that's different. See, where I found my spiritual feeding is here. Being able to bless somebody else. I find it in the store, being able to help the homeless. I find it at nursing homes and at the Ark of St. Lucie, being able to bless other people. I think what God's saying is, where you're blessed is where you should bless others. Support those things that bless you in your giving. See, your giving is supposed to be done with a happy, cheerful heart, not out of compulsion. Well, brothers and sisters, money's getting tight in the church, and you need to fill them baskets up now for us because we got, you know, sorry, that is, if you hear that from me, please come up and drag me off the stage. Please. Because that's what turned me away from church, too. And I've been in a bunch of services since I'm saved and since I'm a pastor that I had to run for the message that was being handed out when they're passing the plate, nudging you on the, come on, brother. Not once, not twice, but three times in one service where the pastor was standing up there going, bring me the money! As they drove off in there, whatever it was. It's sad. It's really sad. But you know what? Where you're blessed, you'll know in your heart when you walk away with great joy. Support those things. If it means standing on the street corner and telling somebody God loves them, I'm not telling you to do it, but if God's leading you to do it, do it. If it means visiting somebody in the hospital. See, the great news, the love that happens here happens. You guys are the ministers. I am busy. See, you think my job is to minister to everybody in the church, but it's not. Your job is to minister to one another and the people in the world. My job is to equip you for that. I am so blessed that I get calls sometimes saying, hey, I'm in the hospital, I'm this, I'm that. And I say, you know, I wish I had a minute to come see you. Oh, no, don't worry, so-and-so came and visited me. Oh, no, don't worry, these people came to visit. Most churches have to put together a visitation team. And we started doing that, too. But you know what? I see the same thing Bob sees. I see you guys loving one another. I see when somebody's in need, somebody else is handling it. That's just like the old church was. That's a huge blessing. Brother, somebody needs money. You better gather up and go fix them. Or give it to me and let me do it. No, please don't do that. I got enough going on. If you're called to help somebody, to visit somebody, to do for somebody, then do it. That's the stepping out in faith thing I mentioned earlier. And where you're blessed, that's where you give. It's amazing, isn't it? Maybe you're giving of your time instead of your money. Maybe you're giving of your skills. Maybe you're giving of your wisdom. Maybe you're giving of your cooking. Whatever that looks like, you give there. And do it with a cheerful heart, because that's where you're getting fed. Rather than demand my rights from others, amazingly enough, this is what happens as people are led in faith. God calls me to love and serve others, to give, and to give freely. By putting the interests of others first, guess what I'm doing? I'm following the example of not just Paul, but of actually Jesus too. Someone told me this a long time ago, that word joy, where do you find your joy? The J is for Jesus first, the O is for others, and the Y is for yourself last. Don't do it because, oh, joy, I got to do it this way. You know, what would Jesus do? And what would he do? And then I'm going to go do it, and then maybe God will notice me. No, that's not the intent. What would Jesus do? Listen to him. He'll tell you. Go do it. Pretty basic, right? I'm not in control. He is. Listen to God. His voice is talking to you. I know it's talking. If you haven't heard it, stop and listen. Because Jesus said these words, my sheep hear my voice and they trust me. You're going to know it's God's voice when you trust him. You're going to know it's God's voice when it lines up with his written word. You're going to know it's God's voice when the circumstances start to align. And sometimes that truth is going to agitate you. Like Bob said, when you start being aware of your complaining and griping and sarcasm, it makes you aware of other people's. When you start being aware of your self-centeredness, you start being more sensitized to other people's self-centeredness. And the trick is not to judge them, but to understand they're just like you. We're all in this together, folks. Man, I find myself griping and complaining about somebody. Here's a little thought. Usually what stresses you about somebody else is something you haven't dealt with in you. Consider that. Zip the lip. Take the trip. Find out what's going on here. Why am I so frustrated with that individual? They think they're so smart. Uh-oh. Look at them just sitting there with that grin on their face. Don't they know God hates a, what do they call that? A haughty spirit, a haughty look. And as you're doing it, you realize you got that haughty look on your face. Look at them people. Uh-oh. What was that Michael Jackson song? I'm looking at the man in the mirror. I think he better change his ways. You know what? I grew up most of my life saying, God, I hope I don't turn out to be like my dad. And I intended so much to not be that I became him. Because every time I saw his actions come through in me, I hated me. But guess what? I got a brand new dad. And so do you. I want to be just like that dad. He's awesome. If I could learn to love the way he loves, and we can, by being led of his spirit, then the world will change, won't it? The world will change. So, I like this complaint-free world thing. I'm liking that, Bob. I'm going to have to look into it. I like the idea that we need to realize our spiritually fed isn't necessarily coming from the television or the church. It's where you're being blessed by blessing others. When you bless others and you walk away blessed, that's where you're spiritually fed. Go support that if that's where you're at. Go do it. Let's go through the timeout for the trip in real quick. Do I see Christ in others, or am I too busy taking their inventory? That would be judging. Well, I'm not judging. I'm just noticing that their shirt's not right and their hair is messy. Do you ever catch yourself? I don't do malls much. But back in the day, sitting in the malls and just sitting and listening to people. Oh, my God, look at that woman. How dare she leave the house? What was she thinking? Maybe she had on the best clothes she owned, and you don't know. You got to be aware of what's coming out of here. It's not, and a couple weeks ago, Bob mentioned, and I've used this in recovery training, it's not what goes into the mouth that poisons you. It's what bubbles out of the heart. Your tongue reveals your heart. So if you find yourself griping and moaning, and what was the B word he said? Yeah, that's it. Take notice that there might be some bitterness in your heart. I've got a lot of bitterness in my heart. I know I do. But that is not who I am as a new creature in Christ. I'm a brand new creation who is holy and blameless, and I love my dad, and my dad loves me, and I want to build that relationship because that is how I'm going to build relationship with others. And that, and only that, will allow me to love freely others. Am I trusting God for the outcome? Or how about this? Or am I trying real hard to make things happen because I'm supposed to for God? That's what I'm supposed to do. That comes under a right, too. I'm supposed to. Don't you stop me from doing what I'm supposed to do for God so God will bless me. I need $30,000 for a new sound system, so I better give $3,000 to the church because God's going to give me tenfold back. I've actually heard that in church ministries. You better tithe. Sow your seed, brother. Sow your seed. And that's sarcasm. But watch why you're sowing your seed, because God's going to check your motive. He'll check your motive. You know what? If you're giving freely for others, that's called ministry. If you're giving expecting something back, that's called manipulation. Just be aware. I love that I've been made aware of my manipulative ploys. And I think Bob called it, what was it? Manipulative flattery. I love manipulative flattery when somebody walks up and they start, well, brother, you're doing such a wonderful job. And I can see the knife in the other hand. Uh-oh, it's coming. It's written in the Bible several times about manipulative flattery. Stop. Please don't play that game with me. Let's get real. You know, I'm just as wounded as you are, and I really don't have time for games. Do you? So let's get real. Let's just do this. Am I looking for ways to love others, or am I looking for ways to get more for me, more stuff? I'm going to do this so that I can get that, and I'm going to give this so that I can get that, and I'm going to cultivate this relationship over here because that might feed this, and then I can cultivate that relationship and get even more. What's going on in your life? Just a question. Awareness. Not right, wrong, not good, bad. It's about getting aware. Why do you do what you do? Is it really for the love of others, or is it for the love of self? It's a great question, isn't it? It reminds me of that, the theme behind The Matrix. You can take the red pill and be exposed and start seeing the truth, and then what'll happen is you'll want to do something about it, or you can keep eating the blue pill and just walk around through life like everything's rosy and never know what's really going on under that fake surface. A lot of people taking that blue pill in today's churches. Well, God bless you, brother. God, I hope he doesn't find out I stole his pump yesterday. Whoops, did I say that out loud? Some people, I don't know. I'm just as guilty. Why? Because I still have my flesh too. And I have to be cautious. Why do I do what I do? Take a time out for the trip in. Why am I so furious? Why am I so sarcastic? Why am I constantly griping and complaining? What is so wrong with my life? Who is going to save me from this body of flesh that kills me all day? Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God that he sent his son, because without him, I would be condemned eternally. But with him, there is no condemnation. I don't have to walk around in guilt and shame. I can give freely. Not because I have to, but because I can. And it blesses me. So I do it again, and I do it again. As we close up here, there is an opportunity for giving, by the way. Carmen starts his drive every time about this time of year, and she collects. See, you thought I forgot, didn't you? Look, she's crying. Actually, this was brought in by one of the church members, but what she does is she collects blankets, and what's, I want to know the name of the program, if you can speak okay. What's the program called?
Blankets for the Seniors for Christmas.
They're blankets of love, right? Okay, so we're collecting blankets. If you can just bring them here on Sundays, and will Patty take them up for you too? She gives them to the seniors for Christmas time. So we got about a month, folks. Bring in blankets. You want them new, right?
Yes.
Or handmade would be cool, huh? So if you have something like that, we did 200 last year. We didn't do 200. She collected 200 last year. What's your goal for this year? 700.
As many as we can, and we deliver them to the assisted living homes, and all the seniors got them, and thank you for the blankets last year.
Is that where you get fed? She keeps giving. Keep giving. That's where she gets fed. Support it. All right?
Thank you.
God bless you. See, she thought I forgot. She thought I was ignoring her. But that's what happens when we get our thinking going. You know, it's not all about me, is it? All right. So as we close up here, shameless plugs. Great Christmas gift. Great Christmas gift. If you don't know my story, this really isn't my life story, but it has little pieces of it in there. Someone asked me if I would write my life story, and I tell them, no, I'm not going to put it down in words because that would be called evidence. So you'll catch little hints of what my life was like in here. I get $10 for them. If you go on the Lulu site, they actually get $15, even though they're on sale because of the shipping, because it's a publish on demand. But I can buy them for less than that, and I can sell you one for 10. And I'll even mark pen marks inside of it for you if you like. And no, it's not less just because it's got graffiti in it. So the other thing we have is the T-shirts and the chip clips. That raises funds for the church. The question often comes up, why do we have the thrift store? We are a facility where people can come in off the street if they're hungry and get fed and food. We will give them shoes and clothes if they need it. If we have an overabundance, and we've had an overabundance of clothes, we have people sorting through the clothes and what's not fit for the shelves. Actually, we shipped, I think, about 12 boxes are going to either Guyana or Honduras because this family comes in and they told me they send clothes home to the needy. Some goes to Haiti. Some boxes go to the Philippines. And whatever is left over, above and beyond what we use, if it's still wearable and still will bless others, if it doesn't get sold on the rack, it gets given to the needy. So, I want to caution you, though. We get an overabundance of clothes, and we have to find an outlet for it. It's a blessing for them. But if you can find an outlet for it, for clothes that you can do, rather than make us sort through them, we had, I don't know how many bags, 40 or 50 garbage bags full of clothes came in last week. Unfortunately, about 3 of them were probably worthy of putting on the shelves, but it was an awful lot of work for 4 people to sort through. I would ask that you please consider strongly good used items. Okay? We have gotten calls where we've got a whole truckload of stuff, and it's like, eh. We help, and we're blessed. We help somebody clean their house. But you know what? If it needs to go elsewhere than the store because you don't think anyone can use it, at least consider that, okay? Just we'd like to have, we're getting a reputation of having some really good quality stuff at a realistic, better than realistic price. So that's our clue. Cat and Doug are set up for, see, this is where they get fed. They're blessed by blessing others. Every Sunday they're here doing communion. So Cat and Doug are set up for communion. And the girls are ready to sing, so let me say our prayer and we'll go further. Heavenly Father, Lord, it is my greatest desire that people would accept you in their lives, that they would realize that you're a loving, caring God, not a monstrous, condemning God, that you're a blesser. And as we are blessed, Father, we are set free to bless others. Show us where we are being fed spiritually and lead us to support those ministries. Wherever that may be in the world, Father, I see your love in the body of this church, and I see it working on a daily basis. It is with your relationship that our relationship with others are built. For all you do, for all you are, we come here and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Before everybody gets too far, we're not going to be in the Christmas parade this year, only because too many people are wounded and injured and too busy. Wendy having her back surgery and just a lot going on. So here's my suggestion. Let's all show up and enjoy the parade. Put on one of your Reach shirts and walk around the crowd. And how about this? Just bless people wherever you are. When is it? December 3rd? The first Sunday of December downtown. The 4th? Sunday. It's the 4th. So we're not going to have a float in the parade. Well, we can be there, though. Oh, and Joe has a T-shirt if you haven't got them. The T-shirts for either style are $15. Thanks. Another shameless plug. We're always looking for your money, aren't we?
Yeah.
kissed on him with my hands. Raised to the heavens, all I am, worshiping him.
Someone asked me if we had a fire at the store, so this opens up consuming fire. It's okay, I was gonna talk over the beginning of it anyway. We want to set this place on fire, but not literally, spiritually. On fire, send your spirit, Savior, rescue from my earth, show your servant favor. Yesterday was the day that I was alone, now I'm in the presence of Almighty God. Yes, I got, he is consuming fire and flame, burn down deep in my soul. Yes, our God, he is a consuming fire. He reaches inside and he melts down this cold heart of stone. Set this place on fire. Send your spirit, Savior, rescue from my earth, show your servant favor. Yesterday was the day that I was alone, now I'm in the presence of Almighty God. Yes, our God, he is consuming fire in the flames that burn down in my soul. Yes, our God, he is the consuming fire. He reaches inside and he melts down this cold heart of stone. Did you realize that inside of you there is a flame? Ever try to let it burn, let it burn, let it burn? Yes, our God, he is the consuming fire and the flame. They burn down deep in my All right. Go be blessed by blessing others. God bless you. Have a great rest of your weekend.